Good morning, everyone. Sorry, I missed a message immediately. The technical way these things work. So I missed a message saying start. So I will now start. My name's Simon Monk. I'm the campaigns manager for London Cycling Campaign. Welcome to our Dangerous Junctions webinar. So we're talking about a very serious and important issue here today. Junctions are the point where most people in terms of active travel face collisions, face danger. Most people full stop. Most of the serious injuries and collisions and fatalities in London's roads happen at or right next to junctions. And in August last year, we kind of set off on this Dangerous Junctions campaign. Obviously, London Cycling Campaign has been campaigning on junctions and issues around junctions and collisions for decades. But this was a moment where I think we reflected and we said, not only are we fed up with protesting at junctions, which we will obviously continue to do and have continued to do, but we recognised really strongly that there was a systemic issue impacting delivery on junctions. We've had two mayors now in London, both Boris Johnson and then Sadiq Khan, very different mayors, but both of them very committed in public to dealing with the issues with junctions, dealing with fatal collisions, dealing with road danger. Sadiq has latterly said that he is committed to what's called Vision Zero, an end to serious collisions and fatalities on London's roads in 20 years. So we are at a situation where we've got political buy-in to deal with these junctions from the top down and in many, many locations. But that delivery is not translating to on the ground action. Boris Johnson started with, I think, 200 junctions, then 100, then down to 33. Less than a handful, really, at the end of his tenure in London, were actually fixed to a standard that would match Vision Zero, that would enable everyone to cycle through those junctions safely, walk across them, etc. Similarly, Sadiq has acclaimed over 40 of his 77 safer junctions programme have been completed, according to him. But our best guess is that the vast bulk of those will fail to achieve Vision Zero, will still see serious collisions, fatalities at, etc. To be technical for a second, one of the issues that we see with junctions over and over again is what are called critical issues that TfL identifies, the absolute safety no-nos. DfT has now baked into its guidance as well. And many of the safer junctions that Sadiq has delivered retain those critical issues. So there is a systemic issue impacting our delivery of junctions, both the pace, how many get done each year, and the quality of those schemes that come forward. And I think for London Cycling Campaign, we just got to a point where we'd had enough, and we don't want to wait for the next fatality. We don't want to say sooner or later one of these most dangerous junctions will kill again. What we want to do is sooner have some action rather than later, before we end up protesting again at Holborn or, you know, wherever. So I'm going to speak for a very brief bit about a top secret summit that we held a few weeks back with designers, planners, engineers, modellers, all sorts of people who are engaged in the delivery on the ground of these kinds of junctions schemes, to try and identify what they felt were the problems. And I'll talk about what they've said. There is going to be a much bigger piece of work coming later in the summer, after local elections are done, where we're going to really try and dive into what's impacting delivery on junctions and how we can make this a better situation. I'm going to be followed straight away by Victoria Lebrec from Action Vision Zero, then Phil Jones from Phil Jones Associates, and Lucy Marstrand from Marstrand-Taussig. So we've got a lineup of speakers, and then there's going to be lots of questions. So drop questions in the chat. My colleagues, Jacob and Stuart, will be monitoring the chat. They'll be passing me questions. Now, if I just move on, hopefully. Yay, there we go. Very, very briefly, the summit that we held, this is what the results were from it. These are very much the initial findings. What are the issues impacting the delivery quality and pace of junctions? Too much motor traffic, too much unnecessary motor traffic, means that all these junctions are congested, they're bunged up. And when folks come to look at these junctions, they've got nowhere left to go, as it were, in terms of signal time, because anything they do immediately impacts the congestion at the junction, but also lack of political clarity. Because at the end of the day, if our politicians were willing to say, you know what, stuff private motor traffic, we are going to deliver safety benefits, despite impacts on congestion, then the modellers, the planners, the designers, the engineers would be able to speak to that. What are the solutions? We already have large-scale junction designs that work all over the UK now, from Waltham Forest, my home areas, from their designs on the Bell Corner and Black Horse Road to Manchester's Cyclops junctions to Dutch-style roundabouts in Cambridge. We have schemes that work. You know, TfL has rolled out lots of what's called hold-the-left junctions. We should just be using all of that best practice as much as we can. More than that, because these big permanent schemes, massive changes to signals, moving drainage and all sorts of curb lines around, costs millions, takes years to deliver. But we've shown at places like Holborn that within weeks of a fatality, we can deliver temporary schemes using temporary materials, we can trial things. And in fact, we should be doing that before fatalities rather than afterwards. We need to drive down motor traffic congestion in London. That means some kind of demand management, road user pricing, whatever it is. But also we need stable funding. It is very clear that TfL and the boroughs right now are unable to deliver big changes that take a year or more to get through construction and planning, because right now they don't know what their funding is going to be in 6 months' time. We need clarity to put lives first above traffic. We need a national junction design review. So we need a process and an organisation that is willing to sit down and say, you have a junction that is killing people. What are we going to do about it? And start to review those designs. We're already seeing a shift inside TfL on modelling. And what we're saying is an end to this kind of computer says, no, you've got 30 second impact on buses. Therefore, that's it. It's over. You can't do this scheme. Instead, what we need to do is say, what's your idea? How can we use modelling to make that idea better, to optimise it? We need a whole heck of a load of bus lanes and bus gates right up at the junction. We've seen what happens at Bank Junction, which was a notoriously dangerous junction, when you just keep it to buses and cycles. Same with Bishopsgate, same with London Bridge, same with Stoke Newington Church Street and more and more. And finally, from the government and the DfT, we need ideas like zebras at the edge of side roads and the yield at turn or give way at turn approach, which I think Phil Mabel will talk about more. We need the government to start signing off on some of this innovation. So that's me gabbled quite enough and quite quickly enough. I will now pass back over to Victoria and go on mute. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks very much, Simon. Bear with me, I'm going to try and share my screen. Can you see that okay? Yeah, good. So thanks very much for having me speak with you today. I'm going to talk specifically about what happened to me. So, Simon's outlined already that junctions represent a huge risk in terms of the number of people killed and seriously injured in London. And the reason that I've got some old data there, 2014 data in terms of the number of people killed and seriously injured, is because I was very seriously injured in a crash in 2014. And it was very nearly 128 people who were killed that year. My crash happened on the junction of Clerkenwell Road and St John Street, which is the red cross on the map there. This is a huge route in terms of cyclists coming into the city. And it was the 8th of December 2014. I was cycling to work. I worked just on Saffron Hill at the time and lived in Mile End, so I'd come through Old Street. I was about a minute away from my office. When I was run over by a driver of a skip lorry. So this is what the junction looks like. This isn't really like a fair representation, I would say, of what it looks like at kind of rush hour traffic. You've normally got a lot more vehicles on there. And this is the view that I had in terms of approaching the junction. I was on the left-hand side, and there was a skip lorry to my right who essentially turned left across me and crushed my pelvis, and I was incredibly seriously injured. I'm going to show you now a video that I've got of what happened immediately after the crash, so if you're a bit squeamish then look away. Let me try and share it with you now.
Emergency ambulance. What is the emergency there, please?
It's a cyclist on the ground, run over by lorry. She's in shock and she's not good.
Okay, continue straight for 1 kilometre, take the first exit.
Red base golf 460, go ahead, over. We are 30 seconds away, over.
Watch your heads, guys. My name's Simon, I'm a doctor. Can you tell me your name? She's obviously a code red, she's got an unstable pelvic fracture.
It's quite possible for the bleeding to lead to a cardiac arrest within a few minutes. I had a dilemma with Victoria. I knew what she needed, but I didn't have those things with me.
I'm just thinking if we can get the team to us with the Reboa kit or whether we go to the Royal London. Can you get on and see if the team are available? Because she needs it now.
We would only consider using Reboa in patients where they're bleeding to death at the scene.
Every second does count. Sometimes the devastating side of it is very hidden and actually everything on the outside looks intact. Meanwhile, on the inside, they're catastrophically bleeding. These patients are sometimes referred to patients that talk and die.
Tell me your name if you can hear me. Vicky. What we're going to do now is we're going to give you an anaesthetic so that you don't feel any pain anymore.
When you're about to give an anaesthetic to someone who's that severely injured, you're conscious that they may not survive this accident and that, you know, your voice might be the sort of last voice they hear.
I know it is, unless this is going to take all the pain away, okay? Hi, Sammy. So she's a cyclist, wheels have gone over her pelvis and right femur fracture.
Good. If you want to anaesthetise, we'll do the Reboa.
Can we have silence now, please?
This procedure is inserting a balloon into the aorta to stop the patient bleeding to death. You know that it can go wrong so easily, a millimetre of movement either way, and it goes wrong, and that might be your only chance.
Okay, so we can start the blood.
Let's go, on you.
She's got a SATS reading now, which she didn't have before.
Once the balloon was inflated, there was an immediate change in physiology, which confirmed to us that the balloon was doing what we wanted it to do.
You may improve things for the brain and the heart, and you may keep that patient alive, which of course is most important, but you are essentially killing the rest of the body because you're starving it of blood, and we desperately need to get the balloon down so that she survives beyond that.
When a lorry, a tipper truck, drives over your pelvis, it's going to break everything.
The balloon's been up an hour with good effect, but we need to get it down.
It's one thing to survive being run over by a lorry. It's another to have a normal life afterwards. Our goal as surgeons, our goal as trauma doctors is not just to save life, but also fix people, to restore life and get them back to their normal life that they had before they were injured.
Can you see the presentation again now? So that's what happens after a very serious injury, and I'm lucky to be here. Unfortunately, the design of this junction forces people cycling and walking to mix with huge vehicles. This is a short clip, you know, it was months and months of rehabilitation that I had. I've been left permanently disabled, unfortunately, after what's happened to me. And in terms of, you know, stopping these types of crashes happening, the contributory factors in my crash were distraction, so some criminal in terms of the driver not checking his mirrors, and some not classified as criminal in terms of talking on a hands-free mobile phone. He was driving a skip lorry, which had poor visibility in terms of direct vision, and also the poor junction design meant that I wasn't segregated and I was in the mix with the vehicle. And I really think that in terms of preventing these crashes from happening, there's some things which are within our control and there's some things which aren't. And I think this is part of the safe systems approach in terms of allowing for human error. There will be circumstances in where, you know, people fail to look before doing something, before making a driving maneuver. But what is within our control is improving junction design and ensuring that these types of crashes don't happen in the future. Unfortunately, since my crash happened, which was in 2014, you can see on the map there's two other women who have lost legs on this stretch of road. It was a year after my crash, the crossing in the centre, Judy Dinsdale, lost her leg in 2015 at junction of Old Street and Central Street. And then in 2018, Sarah Dune lost her leg in a collision with the skip lorry again while cycling on Old Street roundabout. And it just feels to me like there's not much urgency in terms of preventing these crashes from happening. We've got, you know, some media coverage. I've met with Islington Council in terms of changes that they can do on this road, but progress has been really very slow indeed. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Victoria. I think we're over to Phil Jones for that, but thank you for sharing so bravely and being so amazing, and yeah, big up.
Great, thank you. Yeah, and follow that, as they say. So let me quickly get this going, I'll do that. So if you can all see that, so yeah, I'll try to be fairly quick. We've known that, you know, this is not new, is it? We've known this for some time. As Victoria said, you know, junctions are where all the problems are as well, the conflicts occur. And, you know, as long ago, well, 2007 and well before that, we had official government guidance and that said, you know, particularly roundabouts, cyclists were something like four times over represented in terms of accidents. So it's a problem that we've known for a very long time. I'm contractually obliged to always mention LTM 120. But just to, you know, the words say what we should be doing. It's essential that cyclists take and needs of cyclists take into account. But I just mentioned we are trying to balance these things. Obviously, people are not just moving around to be safe. They want to get somewhere, and they want to get somewhere without undue delay. And LTM 120 does recognise that improving provision for cycling may cause some increases in delay to other users. And as Simon said, you know, really that is the problem. It's how do we fit this stuff in when there is all this political desire to maintain capacity. And this is also from LTM 120, and it just is a point that we can, when traffic flows are light, we can integrate cyclists within the stream. And when we do that, we obviously have a number of conflicts, and that's the image on the left. Obviously, when it's much busier situations, it is appropriate to separate cyclists out. But by doing that, what we do, we create other conflict points, and those conflict points have to be managed, and they introduce further delay. So it's not an easy thing to do. As Brian Deegan said, something like this: the more you separate, the more you delay. And I just, this image is taken from actually an Irish, we're doing some work for the Irish government at the moment on their cycle manual. And this is from Bus Connect, where they're trying to bring in improvements to give bus priority and cycle and pedestrian priority and separate everything out. And you end up with junctions with six stages. And those of you who aren't technical, a stage is when, you know, particular streams of traffic run and then the thing changes and runs to another set of traffic. And every time you do that, you introduce some delay because there is a period where nothing is happening. So the more stages that there are, the more delay, and the more complex we make that staging and separate everything out, the more we delay everybody. But, you know, it's we've made a lot of progress in the last 10 years. We've recognised, I think, that cyclists and pedestrians don't mix. We need to deal with them separately in junctions, and we start to get the tools, as Simon said, hold the left, you know, pioneered by TfL to great work, and TfL funded the research that allowed low-level cycle signals to happen, two-stage turns, you know, introduced them up from other jurisdictions around the world, but we've learned to do that. Cycle gate, essentially the signalization of what would otherwise be an ASL, introduces delay, but does design out that conflict. What we nearly didn't make it into LTM 120, but what we call the circulating cycle and pedestrian stage, in other words, a way that where traffic is stopped at a junction and pedestrians can go in all directions, let's add the ability for cyclists to rotate around the junction as well. Nearly got pulled. There was some pushback from DFT, but we held out and we got it in there. And of course, Cyclops, perhaps as the term that's now become current, is effectively in staging terms exactly the same thing. The only difference is that the position of the cyclists and pedestrians within the junction is reversed. Cyclists are on the outside, pedestrians on the inside, but otherwise it is this circulating stage and quite efficient in time, but not as efficient as other places can do it. And of course then we've got the so-called Dutch roundabout, making use of the parallel crossing. I think when DFT allowed us to introduced in 2016, the cycle zebra, that you could add a cycle track alongside a zebra crossing, I think they saw it as a mid-block crossing, but I always felt that its greatest application would be at junctions, and we've done that now at roundabouts, and we're doing it increasingly at T-junctions. But we're still missing some tools in the kit bag. I just mentioned this, I think we'll get it in the chat. It's a report that John Dales and I did for TfL, back in 2012, 2013, where we had this great gig and went all around the world looking at techniques. And we identified a lot of things that were happening then that weren't then happening. And I've greened out all the ones that we've now got since this report was done. We've gained a lot of things, but there are still some that we haven't got. We haven't got cycle exemptions at red, which may or not be useful. What we particularly don't have is what we call then simultaneous greens. You might call yield on turning, or traffic yields on turning, sometimes tight staging, TYT, traffic yields on turning. And the point about that is we know that it introduces a conflict, but it's a managed conflict when flows on that turn are light enough. And it really places the onus very clearly on the driver to yield. And most countries around the world have it. This happens to be in, this happens to be in Vienna. I'll very quickly show it. You know, the point is everybody goes at the same time. Cyclists go, pedestrians go, and you will shortly see that motor vehicles go as well. I think we looked at this a lot for the turn of the corner report for British Cycling. And I think we identified that probably, I think it was Malta, Hong Kong and ourselves, we're the only countries in the world that didn't have this arrangement. And what it means is we can get the junction to operate in far fewer stages, and we can get the delays down, and it allows us to put in facilities that otherwise would not be possible. So, you know, here's a junction. It looks like a kind of cyclops or circulating cycle stage, but it runs differently. So pedestrian cyclists get a head start, then the traffic goes with yield on turning, and then it all goes in the other direction. And that's crucial. And this is one of the junctions on Lebrec Road that's been designed, Lebrec Road or it way, that's been designed as a circulating cycle and pedestrian stage and works fine, but it runs in three stages. And the green time that you get as a cyclist is quite limited. One of the advantages of the yield on turning is you get much longer green times for pedestrians and cyclists. And we modeled some time ago when we were doing the turning corner, what would be the impact of running that junction in two stages? And we found this. We found that the efficiency gains were enormous. You know, 20, 30, 40% of efficiency gain because you're taking out a stage in the junction. Now, we I remember at the time we showed this to TfL, and the view we got back was, well, why would we do this? Because you're giving all the efficiency gains to motor vehicles. Well, of course, we don't have to do that. You know, what this means is that the junction is more efficient, and we can then decide, with once we've achieved that benefit, how we allocate it, and we can give it to buses and cyclists and pedestrians, because that's they're the modes that we want to benefit. So that was a kind of very quick run through from me. Hope that was useful, and look forward to taking up questions in the chat. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Phil, for a whistle stop tour. I was very harsh prior to the start, saying everyone had to keep it tight, and that was brilliant. Thank you so much, and really, yeah, a massively useful kind of set of work there in terms of how the future of junctions might look, should look, could look, and how we can do this stuff better. So for our last speaker today, before we then go to Q&A for the whole of all of us, Lucy Marstrand-Taussig, if you want to join us.
Hi, yeah, hello. Sorry, I'm just trying to sort my camera out. Hi, everyone. I just wanted to say to Victoria, particularly, Phil, obviously brilliant as always, but Victoria really kind of, I think your film would have touched everybody who saw it, so thank you for that. I think it also kind of sets the scene really for kind of priorities that we have. You know, we talk about trying to maximise capacity and different modes of transport, but so much of this comes down to human life, and I think we mustn't forget that, so it's really important to have that powerful reminder at the beginning of this discussion. So I'm just going to share my screen, if I can remember how to do that. Can everybody see that?
Yep.
Yeah, great. So, yeah, I've sort of gone a bit in reverse from what I was going to talk about, first of all, because of what Victoria just showed us. And I think in a way, I wanted to put this in the context of both Vision Zero and Net Zero. So these two kind of other things that are going on in the background. Well, Vision Zero is obviously about casualties, but Net Zero, we have this, you know, global problem that we need to address. And I think the point I kind of wanted to make is that too often what we're seeing is a tinkering around with junctions, a tinkering around, you know, we have a massive roundabout or a massive gyratory or a four-lane, six-lane intersection. And what we end up doing is kind of stealing a little bit of space for pedestrians and a little bit of space for cyclists. But the fundamental problem remains, and we are left, you know, we still have a gyratory which blights an entire area, which causes huge severance and which kills people. And I think that the need for much more transformative schemes, and I'm thinking, you know, even if we think about a lot of our big roads in London, you know, why do we have any roads with more than two lanes in each direction? Every spare lane should be given over to trees and greening and cycling and walking. You know, I think now is the time to think much more transformatively at every point that we can do. So yes, we do have all these kind of quite clever techniques about, you know, moving people across in space and time, but I think there's a much bigger role to be played with transformation, with removing through traffic on some of these roads. So this, I've literally just put this together as Phil was talking, but I was thinking, you know, where we have big roundabouts like this, let's think about removing them rather than tinkering with them. So, you know, make them into parks. Let's remove far more of the, you know, the conflict points in the first place. We don't need to have such complicated junctions very often. And what it feels like, again, the status quo of what's there weighs very heavy on design. Whereas if we were working from scratch, there's no way you'd put in a kind of four-lane junction in this day and age. So I think that the need for much more transformative schemes is important. And I do think where there's a will, there's a way. You know, I see that in transport time and again. You can put bus gates in, these things are very cheap and easy. They even generate revenue. So this is not about money, it's about will. The other reason, of course, that I mentioned earlier that we need it is we have a problem with global warming. And I wanted also just to put London in the context of the government's target. So a half of all urban trips should be walked or cycled by 2030, according to the net zero strategy and gear change. In London, we've got about 27% of trips usually walked or cycled. In COVID, we've had a bit of a blip. So I've just highlighted here the walk and cycle mode share. And you can see there, sort of, yeah, 2020, a little bit more walking going on, 33% as opposed to 25%. A lot of that may just be walking, you know, for journeys during COVID when we were all cooped up, rather than to get around from A to B, just to kind of take some air. And cycling has gone up by 1%. But in the scheme of things, that's really, it's, you know, still not enough. So this is the kind of potential COVID blip. But the trajectory, as we look at it, over the past 20 years, we've really seen quite, very minor increase. So, you know, walking's remained roughly the same, cycling's gone up fractionally. But if we continue at the line that we were at before COVID, which is likely to happen with traffic as it is now, this is kind of the direction we're heading in. Whereas we need to be heading in this direction to meet that government target of half of all trips being walked and cycled by 2030, which is 8 years away. We don't have much time to do this, which comes back to the need for transforming junctions and roads more generally. I wanted to mention just the huge equality impacts that removing through traffic can have. We've seen from these South London filters, whereas nationally we've got about 2% of kids cycling, when you remove through traffic, including from some quite large junctions, you get around 23% of the cyclists going through that junction being children, which is phenomenal for the UK. And I think, you know, far more women we're seeing cycling. And I mean, I would like to see from TfL and the government actually some kind of diversity in cycling targets. And I hope in the next Mayor's Transport Strategy we'll see something like that. We can see here, this is children walking or getting to school at primary school age independently. So this is the red line. In 1970, around 95% of kids got to school by themselves. And now it's sort of around 2%, and that is almost mirrored almost entirely with the rise in traffic. So the main deterrent to parents allowing their children to get to school by themselves is fear of motor traffic. That it's just sort of another factor to bear in mind, I suppose, when we're talking about junction design and all these other things. TfL is doing some nice research on what poses risks. So rather than just looking at who is being injured or killed, looking at the people doing the injuring and the killing. So this is risk of drivers by vehicle type involved in fatal or serious injuries, injuries to people walking. And you can see there that motorcyclists actually pose significant threat to other road users. But it's good to see this in the TfL Vision Zero Action Plan. One factor, though, that I would also like to see in the next Vision Zero Action Plan, if there is to be one, is some recognition of the difference between, this factor of the gender of drivers involved in pedestrian deaths. Around 90% of pedestrians are killed by male drivers in London, this hasn't sort of made its way into the Vision Zero thinking. I hope it will in the next round of analysis, but Rachel Aldred again has done some excellent research on that, which is referenced here. So that was all I wanted to say, just a few points really.
Thank you so much, Lucy, and for that matter, Phil and Victoria. If Phil and Victoria, if you don't mind, put your cameras back on, and Stuart and Jacob, if you don't mind chucking me some questions very quickly to pass on. I think the, yeah, and thank you for some incredible presentations there. I thought they were really, really, really valuable. So what I did want to jump straight in on was Andrew, who put in a very long comment that I'm just trying to scroll back up to quickly, about Oxford, and basically saying, what are the temporary quick fixes that can be done? Because I think that is really important. So I was just going to say very, very quickly on that before I pass it over to the others. Within 6 weeks of Dr. Marta Kravets's fatal collision at the Holborn Junction, which was Theobald's Row and Southampton Row, what we saw was, and it appears that that she was hit by a lorry that swung out wide from the middle lane. There were three lanes, and then she was going ahead. The lorry swung to the middle lane and went straight across her path. And what TfL did with Camden, which was really valuable, was they basically put in a little bit of curbing, temporary curbing, and they essentially made the middle lane a bit of a divider, where there was a kind of mini little cycle track bit that came into the ASL. So essentially left turning traffic is now separated from ahead traffic, and it's really quite awkward to turn left from the ahead lane. So if you're a large lorry, you are much more likely now to be in the left lane going left than you were before. You know, obviously this is one arm of one junction in a Holborn system of one-way junctions, all of which are pretty much lethal, and it is only one turning movement. While, you know, I spent a lot of time at that junction, and while I was there, what was horrifying is you can see other turning movements that are really horrible as well, and, you know, dangerous and what have you. So it's a very quick fix. It's not the complete fix, you know, and I know Camden and TfL are working on a much bigger junction change. But the fact is that within weeks of the fatality, we had a change that would probably have stopped that fatality from happening if it had been implemented prior to it. So that's really what we're certainly saying at LCC, is we're saying, why can't we do, we can spot some of this stuff miles off. Why can't we do it before? Why is it always after? But at the very least, we're now starting to see TfL and boroughs deliver after. Over to anyone else, for anyone who wants to bring in on temporary and trials schemes. No, brilliant.
Okay. I was just going to say, I think you know, what we learned, well, we began to learn it, I think, you know, some time ago with light segregation. I mean, the first time I saw it was, I think, in Montreal. I came back and started showing people photographs of these slim little bollards that had been put in, and at the time it wasn't in LCDS, but it, you know, when Brian got hold of it, it quickly became in it. So we've been applying it, and I think, you know, it's just using those really low cost techniques, but applying them to junctions, and it's just reclaiming the space, isn't it? You know, it's taking the lane up, it's taking out. Do we need three lane approach, or can we take a lane out? And let's see what happens. How far does the queue go back? And if in a 2 months' time, has the queue disappeared? You know, because people have found another way, or traveling a different way, or got on the bike, you know, let's just whack it in.
Thank you. Well, while Phil's chatting, I noticed that several people in the chat, and I've just had it highlighted to me, were asking about yield at turn, give way at turn. What's stopping us from doing it, Phil?
So it's just not allowed under our regulations. You know, we don't have that requirement, that legal requirement for drivers to yield. When we did the turn in the corner, which was calling for that, the report we did about 5 years ago, we said the highway code was the first step. So we've got that. That's really good. Really, really pleased that we've got that. And I think it's just all about beginning to change behavior. So drivers don't just turn left and right with abandon, you know, and do to Victoria what happened. And you know, we've now actually, it's a small first step, and it will take years to work through the driving population, but it's really clear now. that when a driver turns left, they should look in their mirror and give way to a cyclist coming through, you know, and that's the start. And if we can get side road zebras and then we can maybe move towards yield on turn. And we're just gradually changing the mindset of drivers and bringing this in line with Netherlands and, well, pretty much every country around the world. Yeah.
So I was going to broaden that out to everyone else, but what I was going to say was, you know, the word gradually in there made me grit my teeth. That's where LCC, where we are, why this campaign started was because the word gradually is absolutely applicable to all this stuff. And no, that's not on Phil at all, you know, quite the opposite. But I think that leads us hopefully quite neatly into a question that I'm seeing, which says politicians, councillors are often reluctant to back schemes because they'll cause delays to motor traffic. So how can we persuade the politicians, because, you know, and this comes back to that summit and the slide that I put up at the start, which says political clarity is absolutely one of the big issues here. You know, the politicians are not saying to their engineers, make this junction safe. They're saying, make this junction safe while never delaying buses, while also not delaying motor traffic, while also doing this, while also doing that, while also doing that. And unsurprisingly, engineers, given an impossible brief, don't really satisfy anyone and certainly don't satisfy the safety criteria. So what can we do for all of the panel to get politicians to really grasp the result of this in action?
Yeah, shall I say something?
Oh, yeah, please. Yeah,
no, I was just thinking that, yes, it's true that the kind of direction for a scheme can come from politicians, but I've also heard, you know, this is a cyclical thing. They're also influenced by what their officers are telling them. So if the officers are telling them, yes, we can make this junction safe, but it's going to have a massive impact on traffic capacity, that raises alarm bells amongst politicians. So they don't, you know, I think some of this is the kind of culture of the transport profession as well as the kind of politicians. So I wouldn't want to put it all on the politicians. But I do think there is a need for much more transformative schemes and trials, and bus gates can so easily be trialled, not just to remove a single lane, but to remove arms of junctions. We need to be trialling this stuff. And I think it needs to go back to that net zero ambition as well. Is the government serious about half of all trips being walked or cycled by 2030? If so, you know, what are the implications for that, and what do we need to do to get there? So that issue of things not being gradual, but the pace of change has to change.
Thank you. Well, Lucy, while you're talking, we've had a couple of comments about the gender imbalance or disparity in all of this. And I think one from Ruth Cadbury MP about if you could explain a bit more about the why buses and coaches are not less disproportionate, as it were, if I was reading that right on the slide and trying to read Ruth's comment at the same time as remember the slide.
Yeah, so should I share the slide again, or I don't know?
That sounds great. Yeah,
go for it. That was, I think, is that the one that works?
No, I think it was. I think it was slightly earlier, but yeah, it was. It was just that.
I don't. I'm
not sure. Okay. Do you want to talk about disparity and collisions anyway?
Yeah. I mean, the kind of evidence, and it is worth having a look at the research by Rachel Aldred and her colleagues. How does mode of travel affect risks posed to other road users? So too often we are focusing on who is getting injured, you know, kind of looking at the characteristics of that person, you know, how vulnerable they are. Are they cycling in the wrong place? You know, what are they up to that's got themselves killed? And looking at the kind of deficiency in the victim in the way that we do in other areas of law and kind of violence in ways, this is sort of road violence. Whereas the road risk is looking at the risk posed by different types of driver, And also Rachel did a piece on gender there, which is certainly reflected in the London data, which I looked at. You know, the very high percentage of people being killed are killed by male drivers, disproportionate to the amount of driving going on. So on why the bus and coach thing is not, you know, it doesn't have that gender difference, I don't really know. I wouldn't know enough about it. I think you need to get Rachel Aldred on here to have a discussion about that. But what I think it does reflect is actually just the difference in approach as well, rather than kind of saying this is all about problems with the people using the road. You know, they're not wearing helmets, they're not wearing high vis, they're doing things wrong. It turns the focus of attention onto the source of the danger, and I think that's very important in Vision Zero, and in the way that we analyse casualties. And there's not enough of this kind of analysis going on.
Thank you. I was just going to say, I think that is one of the things that maybe, as a relative non-expert in my part, it took a while to understand what kind of safe systems theory and Vision Zero, that it really is about putting the boot on the other foot, as it were, and saying, you know, this is about systemically removing the highest priority kind of sources of danger, as it were, and what that means. I got a question, and I think this is really for Victoria more than, but for anyone, which is outside London, we have an attendee who's raised the issue of how do we change the perception that roads, junctions aren't dangerous enough, you know, that it's, you know, that hardly anyone has been injured at this junction, etc. So we shouldn't change it. I thought, Victoria, you might want to answer that, but anyone?
Yeah, I think it's really difficult because, and you alluded to this earlier, in terms of having to wait for something awful to happen before any change happens. And I know there's ways of, you know, kind of modelling risk without waiting for these types of collisions to happen. I think probably quite a long way away from being able to do that everywhere, I imagine. I think there's also the other factor that because it's such a huge problem and it's so commonplace that people are getting killed and injured, 5 people every day in the UK being killed, 25,000 of people are seriously injured in the UK every year. Unfortunately, it's not headline news. And, you know, I found that in my case and the other women who lost their legs on that stretch of road, it's not something that people are particularly interested in. So I think it's quite difficult to also then garner kind of public outrage about it and wanting to get something done about it. So I think it's really difficult. I haven't got the solution, unfortunately.
I think it's almost a kind of, we've become so, as you say, you know, it's so commonplace now, and we've become so used in many places, not so much in central London, there is pushback there, but so, you know, certainly outside and in outer London, that the car is king, and it's the duty, it falls on the people walking and cycling to kind of make themselves safe. And if they get injured, it's kind of their fault. You know, that seems to be the mindset. But we have to have cars, we have to have the traffic. There's that economic imperative. So I think there are some kind of fundamental points in it. Ultimately, it does become political. One of the problems we have, I guess, is that we have a government that believes in localism, and still, I think, has been unwilling to really kind of lay down, unlike say education, you know, Ofsted, the government doesn't allow local authorities to have terrible schools, but it allows local authorities to have terribly dangerous junctions, you know. Now maybe that's going to change with Active Travel England, you know, we have to see. Yeah. How much clout will they have? It's a very fledgling organization at the moment, it's just getting going. Hopefully it will begin to raise this and actually hold to account those local authorities and decision makers that don't get this, you know, that really don't, and hit them in the pocket or hit them in the funding. So I think that's a hugely significant move, and just hope that it it gets established and can really begin to make a difference require change. I think it's TfL has always been one of the local authorities that has been ahead of the game, but I think even there, further pressure from central government hopefully will make a difference.
That's quite a neat segue into another question, which is there tension? So Ruth Cadbury again has asked about, you know, junctions where and schemes where TfL is adding lanes of traffic, adding, you know, junction capacity, etc. Is there a tension between different modes within TfL? I'm gonna ask the question. I think I know the answer, but over to you folks.
Well, I think the short answer would be yes, there probably is. There is, you know, often this issue of, reallocating space to cyclists or pedestrians gets thrown out because it's going to mean buses are delayed. And, you know, a lot of it sort of, there are kind of concerns about that. I'm sure that is a factor. I mean, I do think there's more potential for, I mean, I quite like to see sort of a bit more systemic change in a way with the way that we do things. You know, maybe doing everything via ward councillors isn't going to get us where we need to get to. I noticed from looking at comments on Commonplace from a lot of residents, probably about a quarter of them relate to people being fed up with having to wait so long at traffic signals, all of which are controlled by TfL. So there is also quite a huge appetite amongst the public for better walking, less slow walking facilities, less slow cycling facilities, because they are deprioritised at a lot of these junctions. So I wouldn't underestimate, you know, I wouldn't say that it's all, everyone wants lots of traffic. That's not the message that I get when I read comments and kind of review things from residents. On the contrary, often residents want their roads filtered, but it's the councillors who are concerned about not getting re-elected, and they're counting, you know, the wider area, not the road itself. They're looking at the number of objections from people in the wider road network who might not want their rat run removed. So yeah.
Yeah, I'm very glad to see politicians not being let off the hook on this one, Lucy, on that. I think it is really important. Jumping back to the TfL point as well, like, I think, and you know, sweeping in the Old Street Theobald's Road corridor that Victoria's Collision was on, you know, that's got huge numbers of cyclists. You know, I think it's 8,000 cyclists a day at one point on. It's about the highest number outside of a cycle track in London. Yet that scheme, you know, a scheme for those roads, which is evidently needed, has been years, possibly decades coming. And I do think there is, we have to say very clearly, while on one hand there has to be expeditious, I think is probably the right use of the word, movement of buses. You know, it's a massive bus corridor. You need the buses to be able to move. There has to be a way around this. There has to be a way to de-escalate that. And I think Lucy's point earlier about bus lanes and bus gates and more bus gates and junctions and things like that is probably the answer in that.
I just very, very quick on, but I think that's a particularly thing with TfL. I just quickly Googled it. Fare revenue, 47% of TfL's income. You know, that, and TfL can't raise that, unlike, say, New York DOT, you know, the city of New York. It can't raise a local tax. So there is a real tension there. Delays to buses, if that means fewer people get the bus, that hits TfL in the pocket, and that carries a lot of weight.
And can I just add something so quickly, just to say that I've had so many meetings now over the years since 2014 with Islington Council, and so much of it has been about, the delays has been about modelling. And issues with modelling, and that's the theme that's come up again and again and again. And it's just really interesting to see all of the things that the other panelists have talked about today on that.
Yeah, models are only as good as the data that goes in, and they shouldn't make the decision for you, but very often they do.
Just to jump in on that, one of the things that came out of the summit very, very strongly, and we had modellers at the summit, was, you know, that there is a misunderstanding of what modelling should be used for. And that is hopefully changing. But again, the word gradually makes me, you know, grit my teeth. But the sense is that the modellers felt that the purpose of modelling was to say, here's an idea you've had, here's a rough scheme, let's optimise it to get as the best outcomes we can for everyone. Not this is a yes or no, but politicians over and over again see this as, oh, look, there's a delay to this traffic. Right, that's a no. So, you know, it's how this is communicated and used may well be part of that. I had another question jumping slightly from, and I'm conscious running out of time, from Sylvia about whether it's better to redo and easier to redo a big complicated junction from scratch, or whether you should be trying to retrofit stuff into junctions.
That's a really good question. I don't know. Short-term incremental change, and we talked about, Victoria's saying about the modelling. I really like the idea of trials, because I think one of the problems with models is that unless it's a really sophisticated model, it will have fixed behaviours in it. So the traffic is the traffic is the traffic, you know. Whereas that doesn't happen. We know that as soon as you put in a low traffic neighbourhood, or you kind of, or even widen a, you know, widen a junction, people respond. It's not water, it's people making journey choices. So I think we could do a lot more with trials. But it's been rarely done, I think, because of the fear and also that yes, you might get that short-term congestion, and it takes time for people to adjust to that, you know. And do politicians have the courage, is that the right word, to ride out that difficult period before it settles down and we do see behaviour change. I'm probably more of a fan of incremental change if or temporary change and doing what we can, maybe quick, you know, not slow, not gradual, but you know, something quick, and let's see what we can do. And we had some of that in the pandemic, you know, we did some of that, didn't we? Maybe we need to rediscover that again.
Yeah, I just was going to jump in and say I absolutely agree. Like, you know, the pace of change during the pandemic and the ability to roll things out cheaply, quickly, grab space, I think was chaotic. And certainly for me at the London Cycling Campaign, I probably look like I'm twice as wide as I was, because I am probably twice as wide as I was prior to the pandemic, because I was chained to my desk for non-stop for you know, 6 months. And the pace of change was brutal for officers and, you know, councillors and whatever. But blimey, the results, you know, we're seeing a London quite radically changed. But that change didn't extend largely to junctions. And I think that, you know, that's the missing bit now that really, yeah, I totally agree, Phil, we should just trial stuff.
There's no reason it couldn't apply to junctions, though. I mean, I do think bus gates have such an important role to play here, because you can trial them. And the other thing on the issue of revenue, you may not be getting revenue from your buses, but potentially you'd be getting revenue from your ANPR cameras. I think we need to look slightly differently at things from the traditional model, because, you know, they could be a serious source of funding if they're done correctly. Then, I appreciate that may not be a very politically palatable kind of idea, but the reality is that it could be.
I think that is where we're unfortunately going to have to end it. We are up on time. And so I just want to thank all of my fellow panellists. You've all been amazing. This webinar has been brilliant. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And thanks everyone for attending.